Yes.
We can start?
Yeah, sure.
Oh, okay. Are we live?
We're live.
Okay. Fine. Good evening, everyone. Welcoming you all to the 45th session. And today is September 9th. As we all always look at vertical three on practical sessions and open and proprietary tools. Today's session will be from Optibrium from 6 to 8 p.m. Myself, Giri, one of the coordinators for Drug Discovery Hackathon. As a disclaimer, please do not share any of your personal details, including email addresses, during this online meeting in the YouTube live chat. If you have any queries related to Drug Discovery Hackathon registration process or any other concerns related to problem statements, please write to ddh@aict-india.org. And for Drug Discovery Tool Room, people who have registered will get access to Slack channel where you can interact lively if you have any queries on connection between the VPN and all the software through the partners. And for the queries, you can write to ddtrsupport@etcdac.in. And all of you kindly type your questions in the live chat, and during Q&A session, we'll try to answer those questions. And this is how the form looks like for the tool room. And you can choose one software or more than one software, or even you can opt out if you do not want to use any of the softwares for the Drug Discovery Hackathon. And then once you register, you will get details from the partners, and they will interact with you to issue how to issue and give access to the softwares. And this is how the Slack channel looks like, and for the tool room. Therefore, once you get registered, you will get access to invitation to the Slack channel, and then you can interact for any queries related to the softwares from the partners as well as on the CDAC virtual tool room. So today's session is on ML-based QSAR modeling and retrosynthetic pathway predictor using the software StarDrop. And the session is from Optibrium. And today we have two speakers. One is Ms. Ambli and the other is Ms. Devika. So over to you, Ambli. Now you can share your screen. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now I will quickly share my screen. So could you please confirm whether my screen is visible?
Yes, it is.
Okay, thank you. So good evening, one and all. Myself, Ambili, representing the partner Optibrium. So before going to the session, I would like to thank all the organizers of Drug Discovery Hackathon program for giving us a chance to showcase the potential of software tools for addressing the key problem statements. And I welcome all the viewers to the session ADME, AutoModeler, and ICSynth in StarDrop. So today we'll provide detailed insights about QSAR modeling by AutoModeler, the physicochemical features predicting the ADME, that is adsorption, distribution, metabolism, and elimination profile of chemical compounds, and finally, how you can rank or prioritize your chemical compounds by considering the optimal balance of properties. The objective of today's session is to provide detailed insights about the QSAR modeling by AutoModeler, the ADME prediction, and consideration of multiple parameters affecting the pharmacokinetic profiles for ranking the chemical compounds. Also, Devika will show demonstration on ADME prediction, scoring of chemical compounds by multi-parameter optimization, AutoModeler, and ICSynth. So today, as we have frequent power issues, we have a recorded session for the demonstration, but we both are here to answer your queries in live. So in today's session, we have given attention to the problem statements which are related to QSAR modeling, ADME data analysis, and retrosynthesis, that is analysis of new derivatives. So once the session is completed, you will get a better picture that how you can implement this software tools for getting solutions for your problem statements. So the key objectives of drug discovery is to identify drug candidates or lead molecules possessing optimal balance of properties. So the properties, in the sense, when you perform a particular assay, biological assay for any type of chemical compound, at first you will get hit molecules. So hit molecules will be having potency. Potency is nothing but it is associated with the activity of the drug. But you may not be able to call this hit molecule as a lead compound or a drug candidate. Why? Because we have not considered the safety or the administration profile or the safety profile of this molecule. So to enhance or to check the safer administration profile, we will have to consider the pharmacokinetic features such as solubility, absorption, metabolic stability, and there are many more. But in this slide, particularly, we have given the three important pharmacokinetic profiles. So when you're identifying a chemical compound, you should have an optimal balance of all the properties mentioned. So if you are identifying a chemical compound which is having a very higher potency, but if you're neglecting the pharmacokinetic features of that particular drug, your drug may fail in the clinical trials. So in order to avoid that, or to identify such situations where the optimal balance of properties are not there, you will have to consider different properties and the optimal balance among those properties. So if you don't find a particular chemical compound to be having an optimal balance of properties, the key motto is to fail fast and fail cheap. So this will help you to identify or to move to the another chemical compound which is having the optimal balance of properties before investing time, effort, and the resources. And the second thing is that you will have to move forward with a particular compound only when you are confident that this compound is having optimal balance of properties, including the potency and the pharmacokinetic features. So move forward only when you're confident. If you're biased, you will have to recheck in your data set that whether you have missed any opportunities. This is a third point. This is very, very important. I can give you a scenario for this. For example, if you're having a compound showing a medium range of potency, but excellent pharmacokinetic profiles, but if you consider that the potency alone is a significant factor for ranking your compounds, ultimately you will have to omit this particular molecule because it is showing only a medium range of potency level. But by doing this, you are missing the opportunity for identifying a drug or a lead molecule or a promising drug candidate molecule. So in order to avoid the missing opportunities, you will have to consider the optimal balance of the properties, that is the pharmacokinetic and the potency. So this slide explains how you can get or how you can prioritize your chemical compounds or how you can rank your molecules. So STAR-DROPS probabilistic scoring approach. So this carry out MPO, that is multi-parameter optimization. It is a patented approach from STAR-DROPS which enables the user to identify chemical compounds having the best balance of properties. The user can provide significance or the importance level for each property, and the threshold values could be given for each physicochemical feature under consideration. So hence, by doing this, you're prioritizing the compounds with highest chance of success. And in the chemical space and selection, so in STAR-DROPS, you will have the option to create the chemical space and to select the most promising lead molecule by visual inspection. So by doing this, you will be avoiding the missed opportunities by considering the optimal balance of properties. And the last one is the interactive visualization. The interactive visualization is made possible by card view, which is an intuitive way to view compound structure and its associated data, that is the pharmacokinetic features which you have already predicted. So in card view, you can group the cards into stacks by dropping one on top of another. For example, if you have similar set of compounds, like the structural similarity is there, means you can stack the compounds together and analyze the properties. Also, the cards could be linked each other. For example, you have a parent compound and you have identified an analog molecule for that by considering or by performing a structural transformation. So you could easily compare the pharmacokinetic or the physicochemical features for these two molecules by comparing them. So this will help you to visually inspect and visually guide you to prioritize your chemical compound. So this will make your research project to be much easier, that you can prioritize the chemical compounds in a very faster rate. So in StarTrop, you will be able to predict the properties of new compounds before synthesis and testing. So the StarTrop ADME module, which will help you to predict the physicochemical features before going to the in vitro testing. So this will help you to save your resource as well as the time. So the main purpose or the main objective of ADME module is to guide you to prioritize the most important chemical molecule, which is having the optimal balance of properties. So in StarTrop, there's a module called Glowing Molecule. This helps to interactively explore the impact of structural changes on compound's predicted property. So by this module, you will be able to visualize the regions of your compound having greatest impact on a particular property. So in the right hand side of this slide, you could see that there's a chemical structure and we have predicted the aqueous solubility of the molecule. So when we consider the molecule structure, we could see that there are red glow as well as a blue glow are there. So what is the significance of this? This is associated with the enhancement as well as the reduction in the particular property. A red glow indicates that the region increases the predicted value, while the blue glow indicates that the region decreases the predicted value. So here you could see that the nitrogen atom is enhancing the aqueous solubility, while the chlorine is reducing the aqueous solubility. So by considering these features, you will be able to identify, or you will be able to derive the analog molecules by considering these important structural features, and then you will be able to compare how the structural feature of the new derivative compound is, that whether it is enhancing that particular property or whether it is causing a detrimental effect on that particular property. So you will get instant feedback on the changes in the property. So this is a very important aspect of StarTrop. Now we will move on to the ADME model. So why ADME is important? Why should we consider ADME? So in StarTrop, you will be able to predict the physicochemical features significantly important for predicting the ADME properties of the chemical compound. So when a particular drug is administered to the biological system, the drug will undergo many changes. At the same time, we can say that For a drug to elicit a particular therapeutic action, the drug should be properly absorbed, distributed, metabolized, and excreted from the biological system. So the absorption is associated with the permeability of chemical compound in biological membranes. So the structural features of your chemical compounds play a very important role in enhancing the biological activity. As I have mentioned, the permeability of chemical compounds in biological membrane is important for the absorption. So the property to be considered here is the lipophilicity of your chemical compound. Similarly, distribution. Distribution is a reversible transfer of drug between one compartment to other. So what are the factors affecting the distribution of particular drug in your system, in your biological system? So this includes lower molecular size, higher polarity, and absence of binding to the serum proteins. So when you are considering the distribution profile of your drug, you will have to consider the chemical properties such as the molecular weight, polarity, and whether it is binding to the serum proteins. And the next one is the metabolism. Metabolism is usually associated with the cytochrome P450 enzymes in the liver. So if your drug molecule is having higher affinity to the cytochrome P450, the drug will be metabolized faster before eliciting the desirable therapeutic effect. So the preferred thing is that the metabolic profile should be low or medium for a particular drug to elicit the therapeutic action. And finally, excretion. So for the excretion, we know that the predominant sites of excretion are the kidneys as well as lungs. So apart from this, the pharmacokinetic features are also there. The first one is the half-life. Half-life is the time needed for the amount of drug in the body to be reduced to the half. So this is called as half-life. So half-life is very, very important when the volume of distribution and clearance is considered. The volume of distribution, it reflects the amount of active drug in your plasma. And the clearance is that how much drug is cleared from our system. So if the half-life of a drug is too low, means the clearance rate will be very high. So this is not desirable, because if the clearance rate is very high and if the drug is getting cleared out before eliciting the therapeutic action, the drug or the administration of drug is of no use. Now, this half-life, volume of distribution and clearance are primarily considered for calculating the dosage amount. Similarly, for the oral bioavailability also, we should consider the absorption profile as well as clearance. So this will in turn affect the dosage frequency. So ADME properties from the molecule. So what are the requirements for a drug to elicit the therapeutic action, that is a proper therapeutic action? The first one is that it must bind tightly to the biological target in vivo. That means an irreversible interaction of your drug with the biological target. So if this is achieved, the drug could make interactions with the biological target and elicit the desired biological activity. The second one is must pass through the physiological barriers like cell membrane or the blood-brain barrier. So not all the drugs will cross blood-brain barrier. It depends on the types of the drugs. So for the permeability, the lipophilicity is a very important consideration. Next is must remain long enough to take the effect. So this also we will have to consider. This point is associated with the half-life period of the drug. And once the therapeutic effect is achieved, the drug should be removed from our body by the means of excretion. So all these features, that is the biological activity of the chemical compound, is mainly associated, or it is mainly related to the chemical features of your molecule. It could be the molecular weight, whether your molecule is binding to the serum proteins or the plasma proteins, the absorption profile, the lipophilicity, and the affinity towards the cytochrome P450 isoforms and all. So the molecular features or the chemical features play a very important role for eliciting the biological activity of a particular drug. Now, the ADME properties predicted in STARDROP include, the first one is log-S, that is the logarithm of solubility. The log-S at pH 7.4, this is highly important when a biological system is considered, that is the biological pH 7.4. Then log-P is a partition coefficient, it is associated with the lipophilicity. Log-D is the distribution coefficient, which takes into consideration about the ionized and unionized form of your drug. And the presence of ionized and unionized drug plays significant role in eliciting the therapeutic action and the bioavailability. The 2C9 pKi as well as the 2D6 affinity category is associated with the metabolic profile of your drug. So the drug should not have a higher affinity for this isoforms or for this enzymes. It should have a medium or low affinity for this enzymes. Why? Because to elicit the therapeutic action, there should be a minimum time period or a minimum time frame. So before that, if the drug is metabolized, the drug cannot affect or drug cannot achieve the therapeutic effect. The next is HERG PIC50. HERG is a gene encoding the electrical activity of the heart. So the main function of HERG gene is to maintain the electrical activity of the heart. From the literature studies, it is evident that drugs inhibiting the HERG gene may cause a clinical condition called erythema, that is ventricular erythema. It is associated with the irregular electrical activity of the heart. So in order to check whether our drug is causing the HERG inhibition, we will have to consider this parameter, that is HERG PIC50. Next is the blood-brain barrier. So we can check whether the drugs are causing crossing the blood-brain barrier or not. HIA is human intestinal absorption. It relates to the absorption profile of the drug candidate. The next is the PGP category. PGP is a plasma glycoprotein which is present in the cell, and this particular protein functions as an efflux pump. So when the drug is interacting with the plasma glycoprotein, the drug will get effluxed, or drug will get effluxed from the cell, so that the intracellular concentration of the drug will get affected. Next is the PPB90, that is a plasma protein binding. So usually, or the important consideration is that the drugs should not bind to the plasma protein, because when the drugs bind to the plasma protein, only a very small fraction of drug will be available to elicit the therapeutic effect. So in order to prevent that, the drug should have low affinity to the plasma proteins. Then after this, we will have to consider, the consideration is given for the structural or the chemical information or the chemical features, such as molecular weight, hydrogen bond donors, then hydrogen bond acceptors, surface area, flexibility, and rotatable bonds. Apart from this, we have additional physicochemical models for STARDROP, and these models are created from a very large or diverse chemotype molecule, so that you would be able to do a predictable, or you will be able to do a very reliable prediction. So this includes boiling point, density, flash point, surface tension, thermal conductivity, viscosity, and water solubility. So by utilizing this model, you will be able to predict the activity of new set of chemical compounds, and you will be also you can check the structural features of the molecule, like whether the particular structural region is enhancing the activity or reducing the activity by using the glowing molecule module. All these models are available in the Optibrium community website. And the PKA is also very important. The identification of PKA will help you to consider the strength of acids and bases. So PKA is negative logarithm of acid dissociation constant. When the PKA is higher, that means acid is not that much strong, because it is negative logarithm. So when you consider the PKA value, you can see, you can check whether the acid is strong enough or not. So in STARDROP, when you run a PKA calculation, you will get the regions of the molecules where the PKA is highest and the PKA is the lowest. So these are the ADME properties which are predicted by the STARDROP. So next, we are going to talk about multi-parameter optimization. What is the significance of multi-parameter optimization? It will help you to quickly, or it will guide you to prioritize your molecules by considering the optimal balance of the properties. So now, for the researchers, the most important challenge that they face is the data overload. For example, I can give you a scenario. If you are doing an experiment to identify the druggability profile of 10 different molecules, and you should perform, or there's a mandatory thing that you should perform 10 different experiments to prove that your molecule is druggable. This is a very mandatory thing. For example, I'm telling. And after performing 10 different experiments on 10 different molecules, you will have different checkpoints, different endpoints will be there. So by considering all these checkpoints, by considering all the assay variability, everything, how you are going to prioritize the best promising molecule? This is a very great challenge that we face today, that the researchers face today. So now in STARDROP, we have a very good solution for this problem. As I mentioned, we create data by performing in silico, in vitro, as well as in vivo studies. Now, how you are going to prioritize this particular molecule, or to rank the most important molecule? So when you are prioritizing, two important factors has to be considered. That is the importance of the physicochemical features under consideration and the uncertainty. So when you are considering the uncertainty, this is really important. So uncertainty is related with the errors of prediction. So you can use any software. There are many softwares available, but that you should use, personally, I prefer the software which is giving a standard deviation values. If the standard deviation of your chemical compound is higher, means the errors associated with the prediction is more. When the errors associated with the prediction is more, you will have to think twice before considering that molecule in your data set. So you will think that why this particular software is giving higher standard deviation. Is the software bad? No, not at all. We cannot say that the software is bad. It is not the problem associated with the software. So specific to STARDROP, the ADME prediction of the STARDROP is done based on validated QSAR model, where the data sets are available, or data sets are retrieved from the published or well curated data. Now, if In QSAR, there is an important approach called applicability domain. That is a chemical space which is generated by the structural features of training set molecules. Now, the chemical compound under consideration, or the chemical compound, if your chemical compound you are studying is showing a higher deviation means, you should understand that the chemotype or the chemical class of your particular compound is not there within the software. So that is why it is giving a higher standard deviation value. But StarDrop has considered diverse chemotypes so that the molecules could fit into the applicability domain of the existing model and will give you the reliable prediction. So whenever you are using any kind of software, you should use the softwares which are giving the standard deviation values. Once the prioritization is done, you will have to select the molecule. Now, when you are selecting the particular molecule, you will have to consider three important parameters, that is the quality, diversity, as well as a manual inspection. So remember, please keep in mind that all this process are a cyclical process. So at first, when you're doing a lead optimization study, you will have to consider a diverse data set, because you're going to optimize from that particular diverse data set. So the first importance or the priority should be given to diversity in the very first round. And second case, like second cycle, you should give importance for the quality. The quality is often associated with the scores associated with the pharmacokinetic features. And when you consider the quality and when you identify a very promising lead molecule, the last thing is the manual inspection. You should check whether the molecule is synthetically feasible, whether the building blocks are available from the commercial vendors. So in StarDrop, we have a plugin that is called ICSynth, which will help you to identify the retrosynthetic pathways associated with the with your novel molecule. And this ICSynth works similar to your SciFinder. It will give you the percentage of similarity, yield, as well as that of the literature reference that is associated with the synthesis protocol. So this is how you take the decision about the most promising lead molecule. Now, this slide explains how the prioritization is being done, how you can rank your molecules, and how you can avoid the missed opportunities. So here, three important factors are considered. That is a potency, absorption, and metabolic stability. Potency is the amount of drug required to produce a desired effect. Absorption profile is very important because it will further influence the distribution of drugs in the biological compartments. And metabolic stability is associated with the drug's affinity to cytochrome P450 isoforms. So the chemical compounds in your data set is represented as the stones, and you could see a diamond. So you are expecting the diamond should come after performing a potency test, absorption test, as well as the metabolic stability test, because this is the most promising lead molecule. Now you have done a potency test, and you will have a certain threshold values and all for the potency test to remove the inactive molecules and to identify the best among in the data set. Now, your particular chemical compound that is designated in the diamond form, that is the most promising one, that has adequate potency. So that has been filtered in the potency test, and now the absorption test is being conducted. So what you expect is that, yes, my promising compound will come in, will be identified as a promising one itself. But this may not be so. There will be cohesion. That means the compound which you consider will be having very higher potency, but the absorption profile may not be that much good. So the most promising lead molecule could go along with the inactive molecule. So in order to avoid this, why this happened? Because we considered each of the properties independently. When we are considering the properties independently, we are missing the opportunities. We may omit the best or the promising molecule along with the inactive. So now, how the prioritization could be done in an effective manner without missing the opportunities? So here we could give a rule. So this rule is a set of property criteria that in combination to identify good chemical compounds. For example, I'm going to check or I'm going to consider a data set for the oral bioavailability of the drug. So for oral bioavailability, we know that the Lipinski's rule of 5 is really important. So Lipinski's rule of 5 is important only for the orally bioavailable drugs, not for the all kinds of drugs. So now you can make a rule that the log P value should be less than 5, H bond donors less than 5, molecular weight less than 500, and H bond acceptors less than 10. So the molecules that meet this threshold value will get filtered out or will get prioritized. And in StarDrop, you have the probabilistic scoring approach that for each of the parameter, we could give the importance value and the threshold value. So the molecules will be filtered according to the threshold or the importance value, which is given by you, which is provided by the user. So this slide explains how MPO, that is multi-parameter optimization, was successfully implemented in identifying the potential of CNS drugs. So here there is an important case study also, that is Pfizer, when they analyzed the CNS drugs. So initially, when the MPO was not considered, 60% of the CNS drugs were identified by the Pfizer. But when the MPO was considered, by taking into consideration of threshold values associated with each property, that is C log P, TPSA, C log D, H bond donors, molecular weight, and pKa, they could add 14% of the CNS drugs. So from this, what we can understand, the 14% was considered as a missed opportunity initially. But by employing the multi-parameter optimization, the 14% of the drugs which were considered for the missed opportunity was added up further. So this slide explains the importance of the MPO profile. So moving on to the next slide, this explains about AutoModeler module of StarDrop. So AutoModeler will help you to do ML-based QSAR. So I will give more details and insights into the ML-based QSAR. So what is quantitative structure activity relationship? QSAR employs mathematical modeling approach to identify the relationship between the physicochemical features of chemical compounds and the activity value or the biological activity value. So there are two important attributes to be considered. The first one is the physicochemical features, and the second one is the response value or the biological activity. As I have mentioned, QSAR is a mathematical modeling approach. So the chemical information cannot be taken directly for QSAR modeling. So what is the alternative? The chemical information encoded within the molecule will be converted into descriptors by performing mathematical and logic operations. And the next step is to identify the activity value, that is a biological activity value. The biological activity value, you will get it from by performing the experimental assay. Now you will have the molecular modeling, that is the QSAR modeling between the molecular descriptors and the activity value by employing statistical or machine learning approaches. Once you are done with the modeling, you will have to perform validation. So many validation matrices are already available. And after the validation, you will be able to utilize this model for predicting the activity of new chemicals. Concept of QSAR, the basic concept is that activity or property is a function of physicochemical properties plus or minus error, that is structural function of structural properties plus or minus error. So we will start with molecular structure. The next is a descriptor calculation, that is the chemical information encoded within the molecule is calculated. It is followed by classification and feature selection. This is very important to be considered. That is, the feature selection will help you to identify the most important or the most significant descriptors correlated with your biological activity. We have different algorithms for performing feature selection. Model generation, this is by employing the statistical as well as the ML-based approaches. And the last one is the validation. So validation, we have different validation matrices and parameters are available for identifying a validated QSAR model. So in AutoModeler, first you need to get a data set. So the data set will contain the molecular structures as well as their activity values, that is the IC50 values. The next step is to split your data set into three, that is a training, test, and validation test, validation set. The training set fit the molecules to the observed data. The validation is to compare the models built and select the best model. And the test set helps to independently assess the predictive power of your model. So how the split is being performed? So there are three different approaches. That is a clustering approach, Y-based, and random approach. The clustering approach is based on the structural similarity of your chemical compounds. So here we have to consider the Tanimoto or the Jacquard coefficient. So Tanimoto is a standard measure for comparing the structural features of your molecule. So by considering the Tanimoto similarity, the molecules which share similar fingerprints will be clustered, and based on that we can split the data set into training, test and validation. Next is the Y-based approach. This is associated with the response value or the biological activity value which are expressed in IC50. So in this approach, the activity values, the range of activity values will be considered, and then the process of training, test and validation splitting will be done based on the range of the activity values. And the third one is random, that is completely random, random approach, that is 70-30 splitting, or you can even perform 60-40 splitting. So in automodeler, you have the inbuilt 2D descriptors. So why 2D descriptors? The 2D descriptors are simple and easy to comprehend, and we may not perform a structure optimization because we are not considering the three-dimensional properties. And if you wish that you should include the 3D descriptors for your particular project, you can always do that by importing the external descriptors which are calculated from other software tools. And now the QSAR models which you have built could be utilized for making the predictions for new set of molecules. And validation, the generation approaches, we know that there are statistical as well as ML based approaches are available, and the validation is done by using validation matrices. So in the right hand side you can see that there are two types of modeling, that is continuous and category. So the category model is done when you have a set to predict the property like high or low, good or bad, like two categories. If there are two categories, you can go for a categorical modeling or you can go for a continuous modeling. And the splitting, you can do it automatic by considering the clustering approach, Y-based or random approach. But if you wish that you have to perform it manually, you could always do that. You could load the training set, test set and validation set independently, and then you can do a calculation based on the manual intervention. So the value column as well as structure column has to be mentioned. The structure column is the column of your chemical structures in 2D SDF format or even in this Miles format, and the value column will have the IC50 values, that is the normalized IC50, that is a log IC50 or even the KI values. Now how the selection is set? The percentage in the training set, validation and test set, the user could give the percentage in the training, validation and test set. Usually it is 70-30 splitting. You can always go for 60-40 or 50-50 because the splitting, the way of splitting will also influence the accuracy or the predictive power of your QSAR modeling. And splitting technique, here it is given the clustering approach, which is based on the structural similarity. By giving the Tanimoto coefficient as 0.7, you can also go with the Y-based as well as the random approach. So here the descriptors, you can calculate the inbuilt 2D descriptors, or even if you consider that you can you want to include the descriptors from other tools, the 3D descriptors, you could always do that. Even you can include the predictions from your ADME, but you will have to keep in mind that you have a very strong literature reference supporting your predictions. Now the descriptor selection parameters, these are very, very important. The first one is the minimum occurrence percentage. So this explains that the descriptors which are having zero values will be removed from the QSAR modeling. So minimum occurrence percentage is given 4 to remove the descriptors having zero values. Next is maximum correlation is 0.95. So this is to avoid the usage of orthogonal or the collinear descriptors. Collinear descriptors are the ones which are highly correlated. If the correlation is there, and if you are modeling or if you're creating a QSAR model which are having collinear or correlated descriptors, this will not have any meaning because the two descriptors convey the same meaning. So in order to avoid that, we consider the correlation to the descriptors which are having the correlation as 0.95 should be avoided. And next is the minimum standard deviation. So the descriptors which are having too little variation among the data set will be removed. So the threshold is 0.0005. So within the star drop, we have the parameters to maximize the chance of getting highly accurate and predictive QSAR model. So this is the entire workflow. The first one is to split the data set. The splitting into training, test, and validation is done by considering the three different approaches which I have mentioned. And we have different algorithms. So the most highly used algorithm, the statistical algorithm, is MLR, that is multilinear regression. This algorithm has got many advantages. The first is that you will be able to get, it is very simple, it is easy to comprehend, and you will be able to get a equation which is connecting the response value and your descriptor value. So by utilizing this equation, you will be able to predict the activity of new molecules. But there are so many disadvantages also. The disadvantages are the handling of orthogonal or the collinear descriptors. MLR is not that great to handle the orthogonal as well as the collinear descriptors, as well as the problem of overfitting is also a key problem associated with the MLR statistical methodology. Now, in StarTrop, we have PLS algorithm, that is a partial least squares algorithm, to overcome this particular problem. In PLS, this forms new latent variable which describes the activity value, that is a response value, and the response value will be expressed as a combination of latent variable. And this technique overcomes the problem of overtraining by doing a cross-validation on the latent variables. That is, different subsets of the training set will be considered and the overfitting will be addressed. And one of the most important thing to be considered here is that the PLS algorithm is sufficient, or it is very importantly, it is handling the orthogonal descriptors. So these are the advantages of PLS algorithm. This make predictive accuracy to be very high, and the QSAR model which you will get will be of low risk of chance correlation. That the QSAR models are not obtained by chance correlation. It is obeying all the features or all the principles of QSAR modeling. And the next important one is the RBF, that is the radial basis function. Now, the radial basis function is an ML approach, and it is very important or very famous for its simplicity and robustness. This algorithm could provide good solution for small as well as the large data set. But one problem associated with RBF is that it is sensitive to excessive number of descriptors. But StarTrop has clearly addressed this problem too. In order to overcome this problem, the RBF algorithm is joined with genetic algorithm. As we all know, genetic algorithm is an evolutionary-based algorithm which is highly established for the feature selection, that is, identification of the descriptors which are highly correlated with the biological activity. So the problem of the excessive descriptor, the handling of excessive descriptor, is taken consideration by joining RBF along with the GA. The next is the Gaussian process. Gaussian process is an ML-based approach which uses Bayesian approach that assumes the probability distribution for values of unknown and update the probability distribution in the light of observed, that is the experimental IC50 which you are providing. And the importance of Gaussian process is that it is resistant to overtraining and it works with large number of descriptors. So that is a very important consideration for the Gaussian process. So the next one is the RF, that is our random forest algorithm. So when we are talking about RF, we should talk about its constituent element, that is a decision tree. So for decision tree, there are nodes as well as edges. Edges, nodes will be the points on the trees, and edges are connecting the nodes. So every node in the decision tree will have questions about the data which we have given as input, and every outgoing edge from that particular node is an answer for that question. Now, the RF or the random forest classify the input. It is mainly used for the classification as well as regression. Classify the input by running through each decision tree and assigning it to the most commonly outputted class. This means that this decision tree will consider, or the output model is being created by considering the descriptors which are consecutively present in the decision tree. That emphasizes or that enhances the predictive accuracy of RF, because you are getting an output model in which the descriptors was consecutively present in the decision tree. So you are getting the descriptors which are more correlated with the biological activity. So this is a very great advantage of RF, and there is no problem of overfitting. This RF method is robust to the noise in the training set, so that the overfitting problem will be considered. And this is very fast and works with huge data sets. So these are the algorithms which are available in the StarDrop, and there are intensive algorithms too, which I will explain later. So once your modeling is done, you could test the predictive accuracy of the model by testing with an independent set. So the descriptors, the 2D descriptors available include the whole molecule descriptors like log-P, TPSA, molecular weight and all, and we have multiple modeling techniques which I have mentioned. And now we will also see how the validation is being done. So apart from the models, there are intensive models. So the basic objective of these intensive models are to get optimal or ideal solution for your QSAR model. That means you are getting a model where the descriptors are highly correlated with your biological activity. These are the important objective of each of the intensive modeling. The GARBF I have already mentioned. The Gaussian process, there are four different intensive algorithms, that is forward variable selection, rescaled forward variable selection, optimized and nested sampling. So the algorithm ensures that the intensive algorithm ensures that you are getting a predictive model where the descriptors are having, or the descriptors are highly correlated with your biological activity. Now, when you get a QSAR model, you can always test the activity or the predictive power of your model by testing it on an unseen data or a new set of molecules. So you will get the predicted activity value, and in the glowing molecule module, you can check how the predicted activity is getting enhanced with respect to their structure. So the structural changes associated with the predicted activity could also be analyzed by considering the glowing molecule module in the StarDrop. Now I'll discuss about the validation of the models. So the validation of models are done by implementing the validation metrics. The first one is the R square. R square, it is associated with the it is the coefficient of determination, and this is associated with the variation in the response variable. For example, if you get the coefficient of determination as 0.85, this explains that 85% of the variation in the response is explained by the model. And next is the RMSE value, that is the error value. This is associated with the prediction errors of your model. So usually you should get a model which are having lower values of RMSE. So if you are getting a good R square value and lowest value of RMSE, your model is good. And you could also see the small R square correlation. This explains the correlation between the experimental and predicted activity. So this explains about the validation of the models. Now next is validation of categorical model. I hope you remember about the categorical model which I was explaining. This is like when you're classifying high or low, good or bad, like that. So here the validation metrics is the Kappa statistic. So the Kappa statistic measures the agreement between observed and predicted classification. So the acceptable value of Kappa should be between the 0.8 and 1. This shows very good agreement. So this is basically based on the confusion matrix. The confusion matrix is provided on the right hand side, and the confusion metrics are built by considering the model sensitivity, selectivity and the prediction accuracy. And the last one, very important one, is the applicability domain of your prediction. So the applicability domain is a very important consideration. It is a chemical space which are being created by the compounds which are present in the training set of your data set. And now this explains about the deviation, the standard deviation. So the ADME module which is available in StarDrop is based on this, entirely based on this concept. For example, if you are predicting the activity of a new molecule or the ADME features of new molecule, and if you see that, or if you could predict the molecule within the applicability domain, we could say that you are highly confident. That means the standard deviation is less. If the standard deviation is less, that means the molecule is promising. They fall within the applicability domain of the training set compounds. But if you see that the particular compound which is designated in the green star, it is outside the applicability domain, but somewhat closer. So you can say that yes, it didn't fall within the applicability domain, but the distance is very less. But if you see the third one, you can say that it is very far from the applicability domain. So what does this imply? This implies that the chemotypes or the chemical classes associated with these molecules do not fall within the chemical space of the created model. But Stardrop considers diverse chemotypes so that the molecules predicted will fall within your applicability domain. So you could say that if the standard deviation of your prediction is more, the compound is falling outside the applicability domain. So it is associated with the chemical class of your molecule. So you should prefer the softwares which give you the standard deviation value so that you can have a better confidence whether my compound of interest is falling within the applicability domain or not. So this is all about the applicability domain of the QSAR model. So now the Gaussian process. So the Gaussian process is a very important ML-based approach. It will help you to identify the posterior distribution, and also it will help you to identify the errors associated with the experimental data. So by analyzing this, you can identify the uncertainty in the prediction. That is by analyzing the standard deviation. As I told, if the standard deviation is more, you will have uncertainty in your prediction. So you will have to reconsider your predictive ability of your model, and you should make sure that the standard deviation is less. Now we will see what are the models available within the Stardrop. So we are having different models. The first one is the boiling point. So all these models could be downloaded from the OptiBream community website, and you could always predict the activity of your new chemical compounds by considering these models. So boiling point, as we know, it is the temperature at which the vapor pressure of liquid will get equalized to the atmospheric pressure. So now, if you want to calculate the predicted boiling point for a new set of compounds, you can always do this by considering the model which is available. So this model was created from a well-curated or well-published data, and by considering the diverse chemotype, so it is a very well reliable prediction. The next is the CACO2 permeability. The CACO is a cell line, that is a human colon cell carcinoma cell line. It is used to predict the in vivo absorption of the drugs. So you can see whether the absorption profile of your molecules are good or bad by predicting the activity of chemical compounds by utilizing this model. The next is the QSAR model for human liver microsomal stability. So the microsomal stability is associated with the susceptibility of drugs to biotransformation enzymes such as cytochrome P450. Then combined log-KP. Log-KP is the permeability coefficient, that is a skin permeation coefficient. You can check whether the compound of interest is crossing the stratus corneum or not. Then next is the density, then the flash point, that is the temperature, the lowest temperature at which the chemical can vaporize. The quartz indices are associated with the retention factor of the chromatography. The Paints count is also very important. So the Paints count will help you to identify, that is to identify the particular structural features which will give false positive results in the high throughput screening. So this is due to the presence of curcumin or sulfonamide groups in your chemical compound. So when you're doing a virtual screening, this will show that this has a particular activity, but this is considered as false positive. So you can also check for the Paints count. Then the order threshold, that is associated with the olfactory receptors, like whether the compound of interest is interacting with your olfactory receptors. This is being done for the odorant molecules. Usually it is done for the odorant molecules. The next is PGP, that is a plasma glycoprotein. You can check whether your drug, the drug or the lead candidate, drug candidate molecule is functioning as a plasma glycoprotein inhibitor, or whether it is not at all interacting with the plasma glycoprotein. And the next is log-DD, that is associated with the volume of distribution. Here, the methodologies employed for building the QSAR model is also given, that is Gaussian process, PLS, then RBF and random forest method has been used. Then the next model is for the permeation to the blood-brain barrier. The next is the bioconcentration factor. So the bioconcentration factor is the ratio of concentration of the chemical in an organism to the concentration of chemical in the surrounding environment. So this is mainly associated with the pollution, that the pollution index of the river water or particular river or any kind of water system. So this is mainly compared with the concentration in the aquatic organisms like fishes. So the Daphnia magna, this is the concentration of test chemical in water that causes 50% of Daphnia magna to die after 48 hours. So this Daphnia magna is a marine organism. So this is considered as a model organism for studying the properties, that is whether the chemical is causing a lethal dose or not. So similarly, we have the Fathead minnow and as well as the oral rat. So this is, these three are associated, not this three, the next one also, that is the pyriformis. This is also associated with the lethal dose of the particular chemical. So you can always check whether your molecule could act as these kind of inhibitors, or whether they can elicit a lethal problem or the lethal dose for these kind of problems. The next is the Ames mutagenicity. This is a highly sensitive test for identifying the mutagenic chemicals due to the environmental impacts. Okay, so the Ames mutagenicity category will help you to identify whether your chemical compounds are mutagenic or not. The next is developmental toxicity. This is associated with the structural or functional alteration which interferes with the homeostasis, growth, development, which is caused by the environmental factors. Then next is the BBB, that is a blood-brain barrier, the human intestinal absorption. And after that, there are some other properties such as surface tension, thermal conductivity, viscosity, and water solubility. So you could use this model not only for the biological problems, for the chemical problems in the chemistry also, you should be able to apply this model and predict the activity of the new set of molecules. And next is the star drop plugins. The plugins such as ChemBell, Inamin, and E molecules are available. So using ChemBell, you will be able to do a similarity search for your particular compound of interest, or also you can identify the off-target activities of your compounds, and you can utilize this for building QSAR models to make the predictions. Similarly, Inamin store is a database of commercially available compounds. You could check whether the synthetically feasible building blocks are available for your particular compound of interest, or also you can check whether relevant substructures are available in the Inamin database. E-molecules will help you to identify whether your compound for synthesis purpose, whether your compound is available within the venter, with the venters or not. So these are the utilities of E-molecules. The mole pot, this will also help you to identify the venter list. The ligand efficiency and lipophilic efficiency are very important when ranking the chemical compounds. The ligand efficiency is associated with the binding energy per atom of ligand to your binding partner, that is a particular biological target, maybe a protein or an enzyme. And the lipophilicity efficiency is calculated by considering the potency as well as the log P, that is a lipophilicity value. It is associated with the permeability of your drug. And find similar compounds. This script will provide you to search the publicly available databases such as PubChem, ChemBell, or PDB for identifying similar compounds. Then next is IsoSynth. It is a plugin available in StarDrop where you will be able to identify the retrosynthetic pathways for your novel molecules. This works similar way as SciFinder. So this will provide you the literature where the synthetic protocols are available. It will also help you to identify the similarity as well as the yield percentage of the particular molecule. So the script will display the possible synthetic pathways in a web browser. So this is the important plugin, that is IsoSynth. So this is the interface of IsoSynth, where you can see that for a particular query molecule, you have got the similarity as 57%, the yield as 96%, the conditions for synthesis as well as the DOI is also given. That means the paper, the published literature where the synthetic protocols are available are also given in this interface. So how to install the models and plugins? So you will be able to download all the models to a single folder and add the path to the preferences file location tab. And the plugins also you will be able to download and install the plugins. So once you download, you just restart the software and you can see all the plugins in the custom scripts menu. So inside within the custom scripts menu, you will be able to see most of the plugins. Now I will show. Now I'm giving this to Devika. So she'll be showing a demonstration on AutoModeler, the ADME analysis, the multi-parameter optimization. So now over to you, Devika.
Thank you, Ankit, for discussing about the theoretical part. I hope you've got a brief idea of StarDrop's ADME profiling and QSAI modeling. So before going to the software demonstration, I will show how to download the StarDrop.
Hi, Devika or Ambli, there is no audio. I think it's muted.
So we will check now.
Okay, fine. Thank you.
So could you please confirm now it's fine?
No, not yet. You can stop sharing and then you can reshare it again so that you can check it out.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, can you share your screen now, Ambli or Devika?
Yeah, sure.
We're not seeing anything on the screen.
Yeah.
Okay.
Are you able to see the screen now?
Yes.
Okay.
We can see the screen.
Sir, but what about the audio?
Not the audio.
Okay.
I think volume might be an issue. Can you try increasing the volume of your player? Sorry, viewers, there are some glitches. The speaker is trying to fix it. Please bear with us. Thank you. Ambli or Devika, can you check your device settings? There might be audio. So that could... Can you play and check? Ambli, can you play and check?
Yes, sir. I'm playing.
Okay, we are not hearing. We initially heard the audio, but later no.
Okay, but I could hear from this side it is audible.
Oh, from your side, you can hear. Okay. Can you disconnect your headphones? Probably that might help.
Yeah, I have disconnected it. It's already disconnected.
Oh, can you play now?
Yeah.
And you can hear. Okay, otherwise, Devika, you can try sharing if there is issue with Ambli. Sorry, viewers, there are some glitches with the audio.
Hello.
Yeah, Devika, we can hear you.
Can you hear?
Yes.
Yeah. Can I play now? Hi sir, can I play now?
Yeah, you can start. Please go ahead.
Okay.
Thank you. You can share the screen. We are not able to see your screen yet, but we can hear you.
Yeah, I shared actually. Can you see now?
It's coming up.
Okay. Can you see?
Yes.
Is it audible?
No. I can hear your voice, yes. I can see you're playing some video, but not the audio from that video. I think MS Teams is not permitting you to accept that audio, probably. Are you on speakers or on a mic? I mean, headphones.
Headphones.
You can remove your headphones and try playing it.
Yes.
Okay, now you can try playing.
Is it audible now?
You have.
You can see.
Yes, it is audible.
Okay. Volume is okay?
It's very less. Very, very good. Audio is there, but very less.
Can I close it and open? Sorry for the glitches. Can I reopen it?
You can try playing
it. Sorry about that.
No problem. No problem. That happens. It's okay. So you can start from the beginning. Yes.
Okay. Sorry for the glitches. Sorry.
No issue.
Can you able to see my screen?
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
Background noise.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. There is no audio. We are not able to hear the audio, so I think you have to remove your headphones.
Headphones already removed.
We are not able to still hear. I think you have to go for a live, probably.
Oh.
Because some issue with MS Teams, I think it's not accepting the audio.
Okay. So I can say,
Yeah, you can tell the audio, please.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
You can start.
This is, okay.
You have to play. It is still in pause mode. Yep.
Yeah. So this is the installation page for StarDrop. Once you register, you will be getting the username and password, and you can navigate to this page. Okay. When you log in using the credentials, you will have to give your credentials, and you will navigate the page, and you can download the software from this page. It's available in Windows 7, 8, 10, 64-bit and 32-bit operating system, and also Mac operating system is available. And the software can be downloaded from these links. And you don't need to worry about the StarDrop servers. You'll get access from CDAC servers. In our previous sessions, virtual tool room session, they have shown how to get CDAC access server access. You can always go and visit. And here you can see the license and documentation part. You can download here from the site also. So after you download and install the software, it will be asking you for license. You can just cancel it and move forward. And next, you have to register in Optiprium community website. You can navigate to this page. It will be asking for registration and enter your details. You can enter your details. So kindly note that please enter the same email address that you have used while registering the DDH 2020. So once you register, we will be giving you login credentials to go for the Optiprium community website to get all the access of tutorials, presentation videos, etc. There are two things you have to download from Optiprium website, that is scripts and models. So let's go to download the scripts from the Optiprium website. So click on the scripts tab. You can see several scripts available in this page. So as mentioned, you can download all the scripts available from the community website. For example, if you want to do to predict a retrosynthetic pathway analysis, you can click IC Synth plugin. So to download this, go to this page. When you can see the installation for Windows and Mac here. So please try to make a separate folder and download these files. So when you run this .exe file, it will be installing on the specific location where you have already downloaded the software. So just click on it. So it will be downloading in the StarDrop software where you have downloaded the StarDrop. So after downloading, you can come back to StarDrop software. You can restart the machine. Restart StarDrop. Okay. You can restart it. And you can see the custom scripts are already retrieved here in the StarDrop application. Okay. Similarly, you can download other scripts like you can see, I can go back to scripts page. You can download other scripts, Enamine, Chemical Space, where you have building blocks so that you can try to sketch, find out whether this can be purchasable or not. And you have Moldboard, it's a chemical vendor. Chempel, you can try to search molecules. It will identify off-target activities for your compounds. So you have direct access to e-molecules also. But you have to have an account for this. You have find similar compounds in protein data bank, PubChem, as well as Chempel. It's all Ambli has shown the video in the slides. I'm just showing all the scripts available in the community website. So these all can be downloaded, as I mentioned earlier, and you can refresh and or reload the StarDraw, and it's automatically retrieved in your StarDraw project, in your StarDraw application under this custom scripts. Next one you have to download is models. So click on the models link on community website. Here you can see models available in the website. These are the models available in the community website. So models are used to predict physicochemical and pharmacokinetic properties. These models are freely available. So for example, if you want to predict thermodynamic properties, environmental toxicity, CACO models, skin permeability, etc. These are available with literature reference also. So I'll show how to download one model. You have various models available. So I'm trying to download CACO model. So you have two .am file is there. You can click, you can download both these files. Please note that all the models should be downloaded in a single folder in your machine, other than the downloads folder, in a specific location, other than the downloads folder. So you can save it. So once you download all the models from the website, you can go back to StarDraw software and click on. These are the models available. I can go back to StarDraw software and click on the file preferences. Click file location. Go to file locations and you can add the path of the models downloaded. You can add the path of the models downloaded and click OK. So when you come back to models tab, you can see the custom models by clicking here. And all the models have been added here. Similarly, so you can see all the models have been, I have downloaded all the models from the website. It's already been retrieved here. Okay. And similarly, you can download all the models available from the community website, like number of aromatic rings, topological surface area, additional StarDraw physicochemical properties, etc. These all can be downloaded and you can load in your page. So we have now go to the StarDraw. We have a help menu with the user guide and a reference guide. The user guide refers to the different options of the software, and the reference guide gives you access to all the models that they have used. What kind of training set, as well as what the quality of the training set. What is the applicability domain is all mentioned in the reference guide. But all of us should understand one important criteria that SAR-based or QSAR-based data, we cannot simply rely on everything. Whatever numbers are coming up, we need to have a justification of what is the quality of the training set used. So, and the reference guide consists of around 200 pages, which will help you to understand the quality of the data set being used. So I don't say everything is good. There are some might not be good, some might be very relevant. It all depends on what kind of class of compounds you are working on, what kind of activity you are looking at. This all Ambli has explained to you. as I have mentioned, the objective should be very clear before choosing which algorithm or which tool you want to use. Okay, this next we have, if you get the license from our side, you can go back to help menu and click manage license. And you can add the license here and click OK. Once it's licensed, you can go back here again. It will be Charter will be licensed and the green box will be activated. And this is a StarDrop software in the.
Hi Devika, sorry to interrupt you. Now I will try sharing the video. Sorry to interrupt you.
Oh, okay. Is sound is coming?
Yeah, it's all fine. I'll try sharing now. Can you stop sharing your screen now for a moment?
Okay, one second. Yeah, I stopped. Click on the preferences. Here you can see file locations and you can add the location where you have saved all the models. That folder you can add and click OK. So this will automatically retrieve in the models tab here. You can see the custom models. These are the models we have downloaded from the Optibrium community website. Okay, we have additional physicochemical models for StarDrop. All these models can be available. Similarly, you can download all other models from this page, like a number of aromatic rings, StarDrop toxicity models, topological surface area, additional StarDrop physicochemical properties, etc. So, coming to StarDrop software. Here you have help menu with the user guide and reference guide. The user guide refers to different options of the software, and the reference guide will give access to all the models that have used, like what kind of data set, what kind of training set, as well as the quality of the training set, what is the applicability domain, this all are discussed. All of us should understand one important criteria that SAR-based or QSAR-based data, we cannot simply rely on everything. Whatever numbers are coming up, so we need to have a justification on what is the quality of the training set. So the reference guide consists of 200 pages, which will help you to understand the quality of data set being used. So I don't say that everything is good. There are some might not be good, some might be very relevant. It all depends on what kind of class. The compounds you are working on, what kind of activity you are looking at. So as I mentioned, there's objective in the slide that the objective should be very clear before choosing the algorithm or which tool you wanted to use. So next, if you get the license from our side, you can go to click menu, help menu and click manage license here, and you can add the license here and click OK. So license will be activated here. The StarDrop is licensed and the green color button tabs will be activated. Then you can go to, you can see on the gray side, you will see the visualize or the data is displayed here. And on the right hand side, we have all the toolbars available. These are commonly used features within StarDrop. And you can see here server status in green color. Where you get the access of CDAC server, this status will be active to run the calculations, QSAR models, etc. So next you can see in the models tab, you can see the models here. There are plenty of models like alternative. We have downloaded the models, this alternative models like to predict the environmental toxicity parameters like bioconcentration factor, the surface tension, etc. We have additional physicochemical properties when you talk about viscosity, surface tension, you know. If someone is working on skin permeability, we have CACO models. So these all models are available in StarDrop. So if you are if you have a class of compounds that giving that, of course you should select these models. Otherwise, you can choose the inbuilt StarDrop models available here. Okay. Next, the StarDrop, you can see on the left hand side, you have the area where various tabs are available in visualization, models, scoring, designs, part, core part of StarDrop, and CSR, P450.3D, Automodeler, Nova, etc., additional modules, so as to extend the capabilities of StarDrop. Okay, these are the StarDrop. I have discussed about the download part and the various features available in StarDrop. So we are moving forward to demonstration. So in this demo, I'm going to do ADME prediction and analysis of ADME data based upon initial screening of data for affinity against HSP19 inhibitors. So our objective is to explore the data in order to select and design compounds with good balance of properties. For that, you have to open the file from here, HSP heat shock 90 proteins from here, where you have this ST project. By using file open menu, we can open the file. The file format can be a file or SMILES or even MOLTO file, but ensure that all the compounds are in single file, means multiple compounds in a single file. So you have to prepare the data accordingly. So you will see a spreadsheet containing 124 structures and their predicted pKa values. The most of the structures used here is 2D because since most of the data analysis engine considered here is 2D, because 2D is much better than 3D in these kind of studies. So if you want to modify the names here, you can double click and enter the name and click OK. Enter any name and click OK. And now if you want to know what kind of data we have here in the pKa estimate, just right click on here and you can click on the edit button. So you can see we have already assigned the details in molar concentration and the units in pKa, PiC 50. And also we can give the numerical data in whether it could be scientific or default or decimal also. These kind of functions can be done here. I'm going with the default here. Click OK. And if you want to create a new column, just right click here and click in this, click insert. You can write anything, IC50 and default value anything is okay, and the column is inserted. And if you want to delete also, right click and delete it. Okay. And you can see card view here. When you click on this toolbar, you can see card view. You can visualize all the structures here. You can scroll it and scroll out. This is easy to compare first compound with the last compound if you have a large complexity of data. So I'm coming back to later on card view. go back to your data set again by clicking on the table view. Next, we can consider the visualization. Coming to visualization tab, here you can see chemical structure data set. So we need to do a lot of interpretation and analysis rather than numbers. So here we are doing more analysis and interpretation part to come to a conclusion that how we can make decisions from here, from the chemical space. So this is a normal histogram where we are trying to understand how many compounds are there between 2 to 4. This is very few. And between 4 to 6 around 28 points. Likewise, we can research. So we can point the mouse over here to see how many compounds are here, 93 points from 6 to 8. Next one is, next there is, we have something called chemical space here. We can click on the chart here and click on the chemical space to explore the diversity of the library and distribution of potency across this. We are trying to, we are going to first take a look at the chemical space of this data. So click, just delete this one and you can create from this dialog box. This will create a new chemical space plot. So a dialog box appears in this type, a name. You can type a name here for the chemical space plot you want to create. And also it is possible to build different types of chemical space plots based on chemical structure or a property. Then it also asks for you whether you want to, you want a visual clustering or principal component analysis based, whether you want 2D based or 3D based, what kind of similarity model you want, chemical space or property based. Here we don't have any property predicted here. So in this case, we have only structure. That's why the structure is active, chemical structure is active here. Then you can click OK. So when the process complete, a chemical space will be displayed here. So in the visualization tab, based on the structure, you can see many clusters over here, a cluster here, you can see many clusters here. So each point, when you mouse over here, each point corresponds to compound in the data set. So when you mouse over any point, you can see the compounds, which compound is it, this one. But let us put some properties and how far we can explain further this particular visualization. There are plenty of options available in the visualization tab, which I can come, which I will come across when I predict some data. Okay. So going towards the models tab here. Now we have no further measured data at this stage, so we are going to generate some predictions on ADME and physicochemical properties. So click on the models tab here. These are the models that are available that have been used available in the StartDraw. So these models have been used very diverse set of molecules in order to cover most possible chemical class of compounds that you're using to predict. So in order to understand what is these parameters, if you click on the this log S, which is aqueous solubility, you have the description here like this aqueous solubility. It is continuous model predicting aqueous solubility based upon in vitro data. When you go to log P, which is partition coefficient, it is also based upon in vitro data. So all these references are available in the this reference guide, which I mentioned earlier. So when you are writing your discussion part, these data are helpful to make decisions. So likewise, you have PPB90, which is plasma protein binding. So it is clearly mentioned here that class low means it indicates less than 90% compounds bound to the plasma protein. If it's greater than or equal to 90%, the compounds bound to the plasma protein is higher. So this is what is called, what is the significance here. Next we have 2D6, which is isoform of P450 enzyme, and it is mentioned what are the ranges here of low, high, medium and very high. Similarly, you can see other properties also. So this kind of level of understanding is very important.
So now we can. Now we will be predicting the ADME values. To run all the StarDrop models, check the tick box next to StarDrop here. Then click on the forward button. So this progress bar will be displayed while the predictions are calculated. When the process is complete, you will see that a new columns are added to the data set for each property calculated. So you can scroll the data to see the numerical classifications, the predictions that are made. Okay. So now you can see here log S, log D, all the properties have been predicted. So the question is, how far the prediction is accurate? How do I rely on this these values? How is the reproducibility of this data? So if you use any software, but you yourself understanding the error and the reliability. So I'll go to the standard deviation by clicking on here, show statistics. Okay, so you can see, you can switch it on and off. Okay, by clicking show statistics, here I will be able to understand how far the prediction the molecules or the chemical compounds that you have loaded is deviating from the training set. So if my structures are deviating too much from the training set, the data is not reliable. Okay, that doesn't mean that the software is bad. That particular class of compound not be there in the training set. So that's why we try to put all the diverse set. So we need to have better understanding on the reliability and standard deviation of the predictions when compared to the training set. We can switch it off. If you want, you can have this. Okay. So now let's go back to the visualization tab. Now come up with chemical space here. We have ADME properties calculated. We can delete and create a new one. So I'm creating a new chemical space. Now we can see there is visual clustering, 3D, 2D chemical structure, and now I can choose properties also. But let me go with chemical structure here. I need to explain something and click OK. One second. I need to select the structure. And click OK. Okay. So it is collecting all the fingerprints and generated the chemical space. Now let us see what each of these columns represent, colors represent. We can color it. We can customize them by coloring, by clicking on this format chart. Okay. So try to color based upon this color by peak. I'm using height PK estimate. So I can say here, I can color here yellow. That means lesser the PK value, this yellow color. And higher this red color. Okay, then go to size menu. Based upon the solubility log S value I am taking, let me know, lower the solubility, size of the particular representation the chart is small, and based on the higher solubility it will be high. Next go to symbol. I am choosing a blood brain category, so you can see if it is negative, let me keep it just as this negative symbol, dash symbol. And if it's positive, it's plus sign. Okay. I put several information in the particular chart and click OK, close button. So here you can just visualize here. So when you mouse over, particular data point, you can visualize the structure. Okay, so wherever you see negative value, the blood brain category is negative, and wherever you see positive sign, the blood brain category is positive. And similarly, where you see yellow color, it is having lower PKI, and red color is highest PKI value. So when you come to this cluster, so you can see several clusters here. So when you come to this cluster, even though they are structurally similar, they have a mix of blood-brain barrier as well as activity and solubility. So it doesn't mean that always intact structure similarity could end up with similar biological activity. They might come with similar physicochemical properties of it. It is not necessary that biological activity could be same. So we can detach the this chemical space by plot clicking this particular discharge current plot, and can say use it for further analysis also and minimize it. Now we are going back to the data set. Okay, due to the I can just drag down. Okay. So due to the complexity and the volume of data, it's challenge to find the compounds which have best balance of properties, right? So we are going to use StarDrop scoring tool. Okay. For scoring, what is its purpose? Scoring profile enables you to define a set of criteria that is important for your project. So scoring profile contains a series of properties along with criteria describing desired values and their relative importance. So here you can see what are the properties already loaded a profile design for this project. If you want to add any other properties, you can click and add here. So in this example, we have already loaded a profile. This is a high or a non-CNS scoring profile for the project. So here I'm considering all the properties listed out here, like HIA, human industry absorption category, health liability, which is for cardiotoxicity, etc. Now I can also understand what level of importance have better coverage. So the desired value, I can give any desired value, but you have to have a little bit of statistical understanding here. What is the coverage of your data? So going to the importance here, you have to double click on it. You can see, you can able to understand what kind of score, weightage I can have to give with the range that I'm defining. So I can say anything between 0 or negative to 7 is 0.05, and anything higher than 7 is 1. Okay, this is how I'm giving the score. Here, the importance is kind of 92% or 95%. So if I try to reduce the importance, you can see how many structures have been considered. If I'm not giving any importance, then all the scores will be 1. So anything greater than 7 only I want here. So I would recommend don't put every time 100. We want to have a balance of properties. That is optimal balance of properties we need. So I keep it like 95%. It will be coming. See, or you can enter here. Edit and enter here. 0.05. Okay, and click OK. So you can also same way other, you can mouse over the others also. You can see the important levels for low gas, 90%, others 0.85%, 85%. So there are certain scoring profiles already provided here, like non-CNS, oral CNS, Lipinski rule. Okay, so I'm selecting high PK in oral non-CNS project for running this profile. So you can run the profile by clicking on this forward button. When I run the profile, it will generate a column in my data set and containing a score for each compound. You can see the score is a value between 0 and 1, representing the chance of success of each compound against the profile we have defined. Now we can see that this is the highest PK value with 8.142, is the dot that row 731, which is having a score of 0.2862. Okay, so we will think that this compound means the promising one based upon the studies. We'll think that. Okay, so after doing the scoring on multiple parameters, you can see the multiple parameters I have chosen here with the histogram. Okay, so for that, to find out the highest scoring compounds, you just have to right click on the scoring column and choose sort, and you can sort by descending. So the data from high to low. Okay. So you can see some other structure is having higher score. See 0.4134. It's it's Ki value is 7.52. So I can rename this as my promising compound. Yes, so right click on it, double click on it, and I can type it. It's my promising compound. Okay. Just as a comment. Next, so you will be thinking you are now a little bit confused that why that this particular compound is having better score, even though their Ka value is less compared to the other one in the row we used before, row 731. Okay, now we need to do analysis on this part. So we need to check where is the other structure has went, which is having the highest Ka value. You can just search on this data. You see the 20th row. You can see the row number 731 is having highest PK 8.14, which come to the 20th position now. So hope you remember this row 731 is having score of 0.29. Even though it is having better affinity, why this structure is not selected for pharmacokinetic properties? So let's do analysis here now. So you can go to design tab here and select this row 20 by what has happened here. Just click on row 20. So you can go to low guess. Here you can see the longest value is 3.793. Right. This is the aqueous solubility of this compound. This is a glowing molecule. You can see we already discussed it during the presentation. That is wherever you see red color, that is having positive significance. Blue color is having negative significance, and the green color is having overall significance. This concept based on the glowing molecule. So this green, red color represents the positive contribution to the predicted property. This glowing molecule tries to represent what kind of properties influential from which part of the structure or the functional group. Okay. And I can go back to, I'll go to the first structure. The 20th compound, you can see the locus is 3.73. So I'll go to first structure, the locus value. Just check the click. Locus value is 4.185. So here the solubility is slightly higher than or better than the other one, because I have given more importance on solubility as well as Ki value. You can see. Okay. After the Ka value, the highest importance is solubility. So they try to rank also considering the solubility. So next, go to the other one here in the design tab. You can see Herg IC50. The Herg IC50 of this promising compound is 4.55. Best scored compound is 4.55. The rule we have already given is Herg value should be less than or equal to 5 with certain importance also. So we here we have less than 5, that is 4.55. So let's go to the best active compound. This one, it's a Herg value is 5.662. So all the data are predicted actually. So here you can see health as well as low is one of the reason why this compound is not ranked first, even though they have good binding affinity. Good binding also. So this is what we call multi-parameter optimization. We are trying to optimize multiple parameters together to make a decision on which compound to be selected on a optimal balance of properties. Okay. Now we are going to a little bit more kind of analysis. Like we can go to the visualization tab. We have another analysis like snake plot. So in the snake plot, what we do is in the y-axis we have a score from 0 to 1 and the x-axis the compounds from 0 to 125. So this coloring is based upon the color I choose in the chemical space. So wherever you see red color, which is more active, wherever you see yellow color, it is less active, compounds are less active. Activity is less, they are still worse compounds. So we can see the 28th compound is here. This one. And the first molecule is here, promising one. Okay. And the black lines tells you the uncertainty. So let's select these less active compounds. This comes, this might not be the promising set of compounds, you can see in the data set also. So whatever I have selected here, to this selected in the table also, these are linked to each other, interactive each other. Even though their affinity is higher, you can see, they are not eligible for lead molecule because of some pharmacokinetic properties, they are not satisfied. This is one part which we can discuss about a drug candidate selection based on ADME. Next, we have a card view available here. Let's click on the card view. So we are going to compare some compounds using card view. Okay, let's click on the card view. This will display a grid of cards here. You can choose which properties you would like to see on the card. But in this case, we have already created a card design that shows scoring profile and some properties. So now let's take up the design here and click on the user design and select HSP90 score. Okay. So based on the score, it has been card has been sorted. So we can just navigate through the cards. You can zoom it and zoom out, compare the compounds easily. So while doing, I'm going to do a clustering here. It is while doing clustering, we have to select a reference molecule. We can choose the best code molecules here. This is the best code molecule 0.4134 for 36. Just go to the data set, the same thing is selected here also. Okay, so choose this one as reference molecule. You can drag and move it apart. And go to analyze and do a clustering here. Click on the clustering. So for clustering, they'll ask whether you have to cluster by common substructure or structure or property base. The next it is on similarity, how much tanimotoxin index you have to give. Let's say I want to give 70% similarity and do cluster analysis. I'm using common substructure. Click cluster. So what here you can see, now we can see based upon this the particular reference, they have clustered the molecules here. Here singletons also available. So let me analyze it. We have to do the layout in a grid or row model. So I make it into click on the layout and click on the grid menu. So all the clusters are now sorted in grid menu, arranged in grid. So next we have to do my reference molecule is in this cluster. You can see highlighted. This, if you want to inspect, right click and inspect what are the compounds here in this. And we have a common substructure. And here you can see in this cluster, there is 35 compounds. In this substructure, there is only difference is there is no nitrogen on both, no nitrogen, but otherwise the one nitrogen, otherwise the structure is, the structures both are similar. And coming to another substructure with around 50 compounds, if you want to further analysis, you can click and inspect. And you can check what all the compounds that are already there. One second. Okay. So this cluster might be compounds having best. This cluster might be having the best balance of properties. Okay. Just inspect this. Can check the property values also. So this is a way we can do ADME analysis here, predictions also here. Next, we are moving to OV models tab. Go back to data set. Okay. Models tab, we have another prediction also, that is PKA prediction. It's another important factor, which is PKA prediction. So we can predict the most acidic PKA, basic PKA, and if you want to predict all of them also. These are quantum chemical calculation to understand the dissociation of PKA values. So we can determine the acid dissociation constant for acidic as well as basic atoms in the molecule. So in order to run this, you have to select any of the row and click the PKA and run it. So I already run one, it will take a few minutes. So I already run one compound. I'll show. Okay. This one already done. So you can see this area. This nitrogen is having a most acidic part 8.6, and the most basic part 8.6. This nitrogen is having, just to click on the 2D structure, and the other one is most acidic is 6.3 in this part. So like this, we can analyze the structures and the data set available. Next, this is how we are determining the best balance of properties based up in our data set. Okay. Next, we are moving forward to automodeler, which is to build the QSAR modeling.
Next, I'm going to show a demo on StarDrop's automodeler. So in this, we will explore the application of StarDrop's auto model to build a QSAR model of potency against muscarinic acetylcholine M5 receptor based on a set of public domain data, that is KA data obtained from Kempel database. This M5 receptor is actually a member of GE protein coupled receptor superfamily, and also we are doing the resulting model will be applied to additional set of data to predict their properties and visualize their structure activity relationship. So for that, you can go to StarDrop software and open the file muscarinic M5 receptor. So here the first data set display contains 129 compounds with their measured activity against the M5 receptor. The structure can be saved in FDF or SMILES format, and you can import the CSV file here. So as discussed in the presentation, we are using 2D structures because 2D is much better than 3D. So, and also you have to notice that while you are working on auto modeler, the server status should be active here to run the calculation. here we can see the Ka values in micromolar. So we need to build a good model. The data should be converted in logged units. Actually, logged units give more even distribution of values to model and a better correlation with the compound descriptor used to build the model. So therefore, we need to change it to logarithmic value. Here you can see a FX function editor. That is a mathematical function editor to generate PKI values. So click on it. You'll get a dialog box here. And you can type the equation as 6 minus log of Ki in micromolar. And you can enter the new column name as PKI. And click OK. So you can see a new column containing PKI values will appear in the data set now. So we have ready to build a model of these data. So we can change the auto model tab here to build a new modeling session. So here we can see previously run modeling sessions available here, so which we can revisit at any time. And you can click on the training validation tabs if you want to create. Then you can create you can click on this generate models. So the first page enables you to choose the type of model to build. That is continuous, your category also. So session also. First we can give a modeling name here. If you want to give a modeling name, we can give. Or defaultly, it will come the data set name also. And in this case, we will create a continuous model to produce a numerical prediction of the affinity. And next, the full data set is split into three sets: training, validation, and test set. So this can be done automatically, or expert users can specify their own splits also. So if you are going for manual splitting, means you can load the data set from by dropping down, and you can add the location here. But you should keep in mind that all the data sets should be in same format. All the sets should have same column name, same units, structure. And if you are using Ki, means all the trainings should have Ki values in micro, whatever more units you are taking. Then only the data sets will merge together. So here I'm going with automatic splitting. And you can add the column name. Here we are using PKI, we are building the session, building the model. So you can choose it. Structure column only we have available, we can use structure. And click next. So this page enables you to configure the parameters for the automatic selection of training, validation, and test set. So we can see the four parameters of automatic set splitting can be changed here. So as discussed in the slide presentation, we can see we can split the sets as 70-30 or 60-40, and we have splitting techniques like clustering, Y-based, and random clustering. Is based on common scaffold. You can split Y-based. You can response-based. If you have potency, you can split based on potency, and we have random-based also. Randomly it will split. And the similarity coefficient, you can use the animator coefficient as 0.7 or 70% you can use. And click next. Next, this page enables you to select the descriptors to use. So in StarDrop, StarDrop provides a library of one-dimensional 2D and whole molecule descriptors. There is a built-in library of whole molecule and 2D descriptors. So we can select the calculator descriptors. You can select, click on here. You can see the whole molecule, descriptors used in here. The tick marks, you can see what are the descriptors used here. All in smiles pattern. And also you can import external descriptors from Paydel and any other softwares also. And click OK. And if any additional columns you have, we can add that also. I'm not selecting this one. And we have finally a parameter for selection of descriptors. So here, as discussed, we'll give the minimum occurrence is 4, and maximum correlation similarity should be 95%. If two descriptors are correlated to each other, or they have 95% similarity, we will avoid the descriptor. And the standard deviation between two descriptors we are giving 0.005. And occurrence similarity is we are giving 4%. And click next. So here, in this session, the automodel will automatically apply a range of techniques to each modeling problem, and it will select the best. Okay. So here, first we have PLS as the first technique for building. That is partial inference technique for building linear models. We have radial basis functions, which is a proprietary technique for non-linear modeling. We have also Gaussian process for machine learning purpose for building non-linear models. Okay, so I am choosing only the we can select whatever models you want. For this example, I am taking I am not selecting IndenC models because I need to finish the modeling session. It takes some time, some more minutes. So you can select the modeling, what methods you want, and you can select and click finish. So when the modeling section begins, its progress is displayed here. You can see. So the first model will come in a few seconds. The next IndenC machine learning models take few more minutes. So I'm not waiting for it to finish. So I already generated the models. I'll show you. So you can see. So this is how it will come. It shows as complete. So you can click on this the top section and right click on it. You can view the session details also. What are the models you have taken? What are descriptors used in for building the this model? All the models. So when you drop down here, you can see the best model is highlighted in a red color. So if you and all the summary, you can see all the models available. Best model is a random forest regression model taken. So you can just right click on it to view the model. Here you can see the modeling data set name, what property is used, how the descriptors are split. They're taking train 91 components for descriptors for training, validation, 19 each for validation test. And R square value, this is correlation coefficient, should be greater than 0.6. And the RMSE value is the error value could better is less than 0.5, and you can see the detailed description and how many descriptors they have used, 130 here. And descriptors used, you can see. Okay, likewise, you can see all the models generated. Okay. And you can also see by unticking, you can see the data points also in the 2D scatter plot. So as a as I can say that the model which is having a highest R square and lowest RMSE is considered here for as the best model. They have considered like this. So you can individually analyze everything, and you can see the scatter report while clicking on it. You can see the scatter report. You want only training and the validation ones, you can tick that, and you can tick the test. The color represent the data points. You can see scatter report gives the distribution of compounds all the sets like training, validation, and test set. And data point should be closer. This will give you the best model. Okay. Next, we can do when the session completes, we will get this best model is highlighted. So, if you want, you can save this model. This is the best model. So, the this best model can be saved, and they can validate with external test of data. So, good model, robust model should have good performance on both the validation and test set. You can see the reliable predictions using the this scatter plot here. And if you are mouse pointing here, you can see the structures of the corresponding structure also. So once if you are happy with this result and all, you can save this best model within StarDraw. For that, and you can check the with the external test to see the with the new combos to predict the potency and visualize the structure activity relationship. So in this case, I am this is the best model, random forest regression model. So we can save this model. We can right click and save the model here. So we can save the given name like muscarinic. Any name you can give. M5 receptor. And the unit should be in PKPSC50. In any other description you can give, also. So you can say click OK and it will be saved in a specific location in your system. And the resulting file can be shared with the other StarDraw users also. So this copy of the session, this best model, you can view in models tab here under the custom menu, custom tab. You can see the system. I have saved in desktop. You can see this Mercury M5 receptor. The best model is saved here. It is automatically loaded in the customs model. Okay. So now ready to run the new compounds. So we will now load a new compound set for the which affinity data have been generated to test the model. So we already loaded a new model here. So you can select this, you can change the models area and the new model you can build any other models. So you can select this muscarinic M5 receptor and you can check the EDME properties also by clicking the StarDraw properties and click the run button. So we can see the new model can be used the same way the other model. So you can see the EDME predictions also. Yeah. Next, we can go to design tab. We'll display the glowing molecule of for the visualization of each combo to show the structure activity relationship. So I'll select one row, any of compound, and any row, and go to the design tab. You can see. And I'm selecting muscarinic M5 receptor here. And this way, you can see the glowing molecule, and you can design the area of selecting the row. and you can design and optimize the strategies to do gated by the blowing molecules as I explained the previous demo. This is how we are doing, we are building a QFA model in AutoModeler. The next thing I want to show is IFSync, which is a plugin available in StarDrop. So for that I will use, so I think you can see then it, for that you have to select a structure and click on the custom scripts here, and you can go for ICC synthetic assessment. The request is sending, so it will come here like this. So you can see now the retrosynthetic pathway prediction. So this is one of the structure that has submitted submitted in the StarDrop. You see, you can see what are the possible routes here. So if I click on the route, if I click on this one route, it will also load the possible literature and showing you what is the possible soluble similarity here. Okay, and it's with an organic chemist could easily understand or get, they get the idea from where to start and all. So this will help you. This will help. This is how when you design a new molecule, the software also helps you to understand how far it is optimally optimal balancing all the properties between the ADME properties, and also it will tell you what are the feasibility to synthesize the molecule. So and also it will actually give an idea of what are the synthetic feasibility also. So this is the plugin IFSync available in StarDrop. That's all. Thank you. If any questions, you can ask.
Thanks, so that's all the demonstration part. So if you have any doubts, you can ask. Hello.
Yes, Devika. So are you done with your presentation, Ambli?
Yes.
And Devika? So that we have two questions.
Sorry for the inconvenience caused in between.
No problem. So, the first question is like, one of you could answer the question. The question is like, how can we find whether the provided drug may or may not be within the range of ADME properties? In continuation with that same question, will it give any specific value range, or so that it is easy to find out?
Okay. So the desired ADME property requirements depends on the drug administration, drug target, etc. And the reliability of property prediction or confidence relates to standard deviation. So balance of pharmacokinetic properties could be quantified by probabilistic scoring based on prioritization, as I mentioned, prioritizing criteria, considering all the properties for guiding decision in drug candidates. I hope it is clear.
Okay, probably, yes. Another question was, what are the file formats that is supported by StarDrop?
Okay, can answer.
I can answer. So for running the auto modeler calculation, the structures in 2D SDF format and the activity values should be in the CSV format. So you can load it separately and you can merge. There is an option to merge the data sets within StarDrop. So you can do that and run the calculation for auto modeler.
Okay. And we are due to time limitation, I'm restricting with the question, but there's a very important question that could you please showcase how to access the CDAX server? That will be the final.
Yeah, sure. So the very first step is to install the FortiClient VPN software. So once you have the credentials.
Can you share the screen? Sorry, can you please share the screen?
My screen is not visible.
Lights are not visible.
It is still on ICSIN. That's what we can see.
Yeah.
I don't know whether you're showing something else here.
Is it visible now?
No. I think you have to share it again.
Actually, I have shared it. I'll try sharing again.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
Is it visible now?
It's coming up.
Yeah. Yeah, so is it visible now, sir?
Yes.
Okay, so for the CDAC access, the very first step is to install the FortiClient VPN software. So once you get the credentials from the CDAC server, so connect the VPN first with the token provided from the then the next is the how to access the StarDrop license server setup. So to as Devika showed, you can go to help menu and manage, click on the manage license and you can add the license which is provided. So once that is done, you can enter the IP address of the server and the port as 9190. So once you're done with this, you can click on the connect so that the license server is getting connected. So for running the QSAR auto modeler, after the license server is connected, you can go to the preferences in the auto modeler tab. So enter the host name or the IP address in the name field. The port number should be entered as 9050. So once the entered all the data, you can click on the test button. And once everything is proper, the report will be success, and then you can run the QSAR modeling. Yeah, that's all. Thank you so much, everyone. And we are extremely sorry for the technical glitches and for extending the session.
Okay, absolutely fine. That happens in between. Anyway, thank you so much, both of you, for a bit lengthy, extensive session. Looking forward to the further details also. So I would like to now thank all the training team, the DDH training team, as well as the members of Virtual Tool Room, CDAC and MyGov, and all the partners who are joining with us. I think today is the last session for Optibrium also. Looking forward all the participants using all the partner tools. Thank you so much. Have a great evening and bye for now.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.